Let's go to some news, and what we're going to do this time is we're going to try to get some of this news that are coming out and tie them up with the stuff we learned, simply because they can show up on the customs broker exam. So JFK port of JFK, which is right here in my hometown of New York City, we had a gentleman who was apprehended with birds, finches, which were concealed inside his baggage, and they were concealed inside of hair rollers. So this young man, the 26 year old man from Guyana, he was not criminally charged, but assessed a civil penalty in the amount of $300, and was, this is a punchline, and he was allowed to withdraw his request for admission and placed on the next, well, on the Guyana bound flight for Monday. All right, so now all of you were asked, not this week but last week, to become familiar with fines, penalties, and forfeiture. So I just wanted to drop a few lines about this penalty thing. Obviously, those birds and the way they were brought in, there was an intent not to declare this stuff. Rather, there was an intent to probably smuggle them by as a contraband. If you want to see what the finches look like, they look like this. They just those pretty little birds. What's interesting is they were used to save people lives up until even 1986 to detect carbon monoxide in the coal mines. So those finches, what's going on with them? So they would be probably classified under 0106-3901 and subject to duty of 1.8%. Of course, duty is not the end of the story, because you have to comply with licensing requirements by the Fish and Wildlife Services, and those other you have to go through the quarantine requirements. So those you get import permits. So those licensing requirements is the biggest struggle here. It's not the duty, it's the amount of paperwork with the Fish and Wildlife that you have to go through. So if you go to the guidelines for the disposition of so first of all, what are the violations? So we know from looking at fines and penalties and forfeiture statutes that the violation assessments there are addressed in a part 171 of the Code of Federal Regulations. At the very end of the part of 171, we have four different appendices. Three of them have been tested on the exam. One of them is, and they are all written down by statutes, and they're written down according to the statute. And the reason for those statutes is because those statutes have to deal, remember, the statute is something from the Congress, right? It's the statutory act from the Congress. So in this situation, we have four appendices dealing with different types of violations. So the 1497 one deals with something with like what we have the case here, which is a smuggling. The 1592 deals with a violation which can be applicable to both the importer or customs brokers, and we are talking about the fraud, negligence, and gross negligence when you're doing entry. So let's say this gentleman was not smuggling, but let's say he said, no, I don't have birds, but I have snakes, let's say, or birds, but of a different kind, like parrots. So this would be an issue for very many reasons, not only the fish and wildlife, also the CITES, because many of those animals are prescribed from trade because they are protected species. So that would be 1592 example. The 1641 example is the example of which would be should be very close and dear to you guys, because it deals with the regulation of licensed customs brokers. Out of this statute arise those regulations that you have been most of the regulations that you have been studying, and this statute deals with licensing requirements for the brokers that deal with customs business, deals with the customs business definition, and of course deals with penalties. And 1593A, this is a drawback provision. Drawback is not. I haven't had you read the drawback chapter. I'll probably have you do that next week. But it deals with provisions where you bring something in and you export it either in the same way because you just let's say you didn't sell it, or because you used it in as an input in some manufacturing process of the item which is later on which was later on exported. So and of course there is a room for error right there as well. So those are the guys. And if we're looking at the one that we're talking about, 1497, if we take a look at the provision itself, the penalties for failure to declare. All right, this is the amount of penalty is equal to if the article is controlled substance. Well, we don't have that. 500 or 1,000 percent of the value of the article. Well, that's dealing with controlled substance, so we have birds. That's not controlled substance, so it will be the value of the article. And those guidelines, they're designed to act as a system of checks and balances to make sure that those penalties are being followed. Because there is mitigation stuff like what should be forgiven, what should not be forgiven. If you are let's say if you are the infrequent traveler, this is your first time. This is the mitigating factor for you, and we can see that only $300 of the civil penalty was assessed, which is pretty good in my view, because that guy got off easy. Of course, what's the worst thing that could happen? And what's interesting here is why would he, was he allowed to withdraw his request? Oh, okay, all we have is this news information, but I think the reason was because he was told at the JFK airport by customs that listen, if we allow you to enter, we are going to recommend we're going to well they don't actually charge with well prosecution they can arrest, but the prosecution itself is handled by the Office of Prosecutor. In this case, it would be either East, I think it would be the Eastern District of New York, because that's their jurisdiction. It can be Southern District, but Eastern District sits in Brooklyn, and this is they handle most of the stuff there. Arresting people would be the DHI, Department of Homeland Investigations. This is what they probably told them, that if you smuggle, you're facing up to 20 years in prison. So that's the smuggling statute right there. Of course, you guys do not have to know that for the exam, but I think it's helpful to understand greater picture, if you will, of why things happen the way they are. So obviously that 20 year up to, he, of course he probably would not get 20 years in prison because there are sentencing guidelines just like those part 171 appendices which courts have to follow, but still this is something which is very unpleasant. All right, so this is with respect to our gentleman from Guyana. Next on the list is so I just gonna I'm not gonna spend too much time about on this. I'm going to just to drop you the line and once you pass the exam or once well, let's put it this way. So customs you all know the classification stuff is very important, right? So customs is putting out a series of webinars. They're gonna run through August, and they're going to discuss various commodities. I think once you become a licensed customs broker, what is useful is not only to keep your head within your desk, but also try to look at the outside world and understand why are things being done the way they're done. And one way to do that is to continuously educate yourself, which is extremely important, especially in nowadays world where this particular continuous education is available and very often it's free. So you have the link, put it on your calendar for me. At least I highly recommend for you to attend at least one of them so that way you guys are knowing not even if it's something which is not related to the commodity which you deal with, you will get acquainted with the methodology. And not only the methodology, because we all looked at the general rules of interpretation and we have the basic idea of how it works, but the methodology of what I call interpretative methodology of CBP officials and how they think whenever they do things they do. Because this particular National Commodity Specialist Division is the division which is the first line of classification inquiries within the Customs and Border Protection. So you have that link. All right, so the next link, well, I guess I wanted to share with you this link and but those of you who need they already know, but pretty much the point of this link was that there are two different types of formats for the exam. One is this one, this is for the take home, and another one is available in person website. We'll talk more about it, but again, there when I was setting the stuff up for the stream today, their website was down too. So, several pointers that I wanted to address, but I couldn't address because of this exam was not there. But just know that there are two versions. There is one version for take home, which is this one, the one on the screen, and then there is the practice version for when you show up at the on the site. All right. So the next announcement. Okay, let me check if the Pearson website is up. Well, oh, okay, good news. Pearson website is up. So maybe it was just temporary. All right. So view exam. Oops. No. That's not it. Okay, so you go to that exam. And you see that, so I just dropped down the link, and you see that sample exam? All right, guys, extremely important that you know this exam like the back of your hand, because last thing you want to do is lose time when you show up on this miscellaneous stuff, like agreement stuff, the questions which are going to be for just general statistical purposes. Like I think they have 3 or 5 questions for the survey, all right, post-examination evaluation survey. Navigation is extremely important. So I said it at the beginning, I'm right now it's as important as ever that you go in there and not just once. Go there several times, preferably on different days, and make sure that you are you get familiar with this exam. All right, so that's for this one. I'll be going over more details of what to look for, but for now, let me bring your attention to this introduction outline, which I had started with this particular class. No, I mean not class, but the series of classes. I'm talking about the January 7th, I think. What I've done some updates. It looks kind of clumsy because I'm giving it to you in a Word form, so that way you guys can download that link and open it using the Word in case you don't have that PDF Word converter. But extremely important, what's important here are the charts. Recall that whenever you show up and sit on the exam, first of all, you must have a strategy in mind, right? And the strategy here we're talking about is which questions you do first. Recall, before it was kind of not so clear, but now it should be more clear that evaluation questions, after you had a chance to take a stab at them, they take more time simply because you do that formula analysis, you try to take out the DDP stuff, you go through excess, you go through divisions. Those are the type of stuff which take time. It's not because you may not be able to get it because you don't know it, even though that may be the case too. That's why we need to practice more on this. But it's even if you know what's going on, it's just the calculation, the mathematical part just takes time. So here it's extremely important for you to leave them for last. So evaluation stuff gets the last step here. Of course, non-evaluation and non-FTA, non-free trade agreements, they're the first ones on the list. Classification come next, and then classification FTA combinations. FTA is a tricky point because in case of a free trade agreement, it can refer to both, let's say, HTS-US, it can refer to both the CFR. In some cases, they can overlap, as we saw in the last class when we looked at the updates, right? We saw, for example, the Dominican Republic, right, the P+, is overlapping in the CFR and in the HTS-US. So the reason I did this in the Word form, of course, so that way you can copy and paste this and adjust it to your own liking. But every one of you have to have a plan. You can't just start from 1 and finish with 80. You have to jump because that will make your work more efficient. So I just dropped down the link, so you have that. Let me see. Okay, so another thing that I updated in this particular outline, which we talked about on January 7th, I'm sorry. So back then I did not. So we have a chart on general provisions. I updated that particular chart newly added general provisions. Specifically, we're talking about Nepal. Specifically, we're talking about USMCA, which will not be tested because it's not part of the exam, exam material, which you're required to bring. And it also has the Japan. I also expanded this particular table so that way you guys have the special product indicator symbol over here. So that way you're able to associate, let's say, GSP with this SPA or Nepal with this SPA. And I provided the location. Well, location was there, but I did a little bit update because Nepal kind of like weirdly creeps its way in into the general number 4, which used to be just GSP, general system of preferences. Now it's the last paragraph of the GSP part. But pretty much this is just a quick reference so you guys know where to jump right away. So please use this updated chart, not the one that was provided to you back in January 7th, and the one found in the textbook in the introduction chapter. Okay, now. Next on the list, and I'm very thankful to everyone, and especially the diligent students who keep me on the toes, because what I do have here is, as you know, I'm a human being, so I'm bound to make mistakes myself, and especially when it comes to CBP regulations, sometimes those CBP stuff, even though the customs license broker exam is designed to test on the basic stuff, but you all know that sometimes things can get complicated. So I can get confused here and there. I can miss stuff here and there. So please don't be too harsh on me. So what I have here. I have an update on one particular point of the outline. So let me see if I can get it to work. Okay, no wonder it doesn't work. Oh, well. Started. So I need to go. Okay, here. All right, so let me drop down the link. So pretty much customs license broker exam, customs license customs bro. So I just dropped down the link. But let me make a point here. So customs broker responsibilities is one of the pillars of the exam. Without knowing this, you can't pass it. You have to know three pillars, pretty much. The customs broker exam is based on three pillars, and then there is miscellaneous stuff. Pillar number one is the entry, which we started way back in January, right? Pillar number two is classification. Without that, you can't pass. Pillar number three is customs broker, license customs broker responsibilities. So within this chapter, which is located in volume two, this particular 111.51, I had this stuff mixed up. So I had this one in the original textbook that you guys have with prejudice and this one without prejudice. It's a minor note because I don't think they will have too many, if any, questions on the particular this particular section 111.51. But nevertheless, I'm very thankful for you guys. So that's the particular regulation that I'm talking, the section that I'm talking about. So that was updated. So I'm really thankful for pointing this out. Okay, so you have the link. All right. So another update. Deals with liquidation of duties outline, liquidation of duties chapter. Here it's in the formula outline. Let me drop down the link so you guys have it. By the way, speaking on links, so I do understand that sometimes for various reasons those links, you are not able to capture those things because you are not able to attend the live stream. So this is a message for those who watch the stuff later. Okay. So I know a number of you have come to me and says, listen, can you please give me this link and that link? But as you have noticed, I find it sometimes I have the document, like a PDF document, especially when I'm doing the classification stuff. Sometimes I do have a link for just for the ease of communications, and I find those links are easier to convey the messages and documents because simply you just need to click, paste, download, copy, paste, and download. I'm sorry. But sometimes when you get too many links, you can get confused. So what I can do, if you would like me to, let me show you something. So at the way I run the classes, and I did mention this before to some of you, I have an outline. But sometimes I deviate from the outline, but pretty much this is my plan, and it's been finalized right before if there is some kind of new information, right? So let's say that my website was down, so I had to update the stream protocol a little bit. But basically it has the list of all the links I'm being used throughout this session, for example. If you like, I can. It's all the information that I'm talking about right now. So if you like, at the end of the stream, I can make it a practice of sending it to you. The problem is it may be confusing. So if you guys want, and this goes out to everyone. So if you guys want me to do this, I have no issues. But if it will make it more confusing, then you already have too much information to deal with, so I don't want anyone to get overwhelmed. That's all. All right. So liquidation of duties. We have with respect to the liquidation part. Part 159.9. So again, thank you for bringing this up to me because I did run a class back in 2018 on this particular topic, and that particular topic dealt was updated as a part of this federal register electronic notice of liquidation. Where so this is 2016 notice. But notice they were updated, they became effective in 2017. And pretty much they said, okay, so the liquidation notice will no longer be posted at physical location. You need to go to the CBP website and look for it there. And therefore, this form, which was being used to provide the notices of liquidation, became kind of outmoded. So the website where you go to for the notices of notice of liquidation, they're here. And what if you read it carefully, you will see that. Hold on a second. you will see that that CBP form 4333 is still around. And you know, customs sometimes are sticklers for those forms. They want to say, okay, tell me the form number, which is notice of liquidation, or it used to be the courtesy notice of liquidation is provided via form number blank, and you have all those answer choices that you need to choose from. So that was important, but then it was changed, right? It was changed by way of everything going to the online world. And I haven't seen any questions since then based that were testing on this 159.11 because of that. But because the version of the book that went to print is predates that particular notice and predates that particular environment, you have pretty much the information which needs to be updated. So that update comes by virtue of this outline, which says, okay, so you need to go to this website, and that website, what's going on with the internet? Okay, I have to reload it. So yeah, that's pretty much the portion, that 159 portion is the only portion that got updated as far as this particular outline is concerned.